The world is full of noise, and all too often, that noise attempts to drown out the message of hope that moms so desperately need to hear.
It is our calling to help you reach this level of freedom, to understand who you were created to be, and to walk fully in your purpose. From daily routines to slaying giants, we're going to talk about things that matter, help you find a balance that works for you, and tackle mindsets that hold you back.
We craft each episode to speak to a specific challenge in motherhood, leaving you feeling inspired and equipped with tools to make changes that will propel you on the path to your calling. We are about purpose, identity, and freedom. I'm Dr. Bayless.
And I'm Jackie Bailey.
And this is Point of Decision. So today we want to talk about imposter syndrome.
We are actually going to do a real talk for you today. Just Leslie and I talking about the imposter syndrome that we all face in different moments of our lives.
We've both felt like an imposter and just wanting to minister to other women, but right here in the thick of something that really means that we need some ministry, and how we've had to reach out to each other and other people to help us navigate that. And what imposter syndrome really is, actually that root of pride, because we are telling God that we're not worthy of the calling he gave to us, which he gave it to us because he wanted us to do it. It doesn't matter whether we think we're worthy or not. We need to know that he is worthy. When we're worried about whether we're worthy or not, we're taking away his part in it, because we're like, oh, I'm not worthy about this, God. He goes, but I am. I am worthy of this. And I do get the glory when you step out and I can work through whatever it is that you think is not good enough. So,
right. Amen. Yeah, I totally agree with that. I feel like the Holy Spirit is in us, and that's what makes us worthy, is because He's worthy and he's in us. So when we really embrace that part of our identity, that, okay, wait, I've invited Jesus into my life as my personal savior. And through that, his Holy Spirit has literally possessed my body. And I know a lot of times the word possess gets such a bad rap because of the other way it's used. But when we use it in the good sense, that literally the Holy Spirit has come into our body and we get to allow the Holy Spirit to take over, when we don't have the strength, he does. And exactly. So we get to really press into his strength. And you and I have had lots of practice and experience and leaning into his strength, because there's so many times where we just can't do it.
Exactly.
But he can do it through us.
Exactly. I want to really convey some of the things that we're going through right now that people in different walks of life can relate to, but that mom who feels like an imposter, I want to do this thing, but, and you know, even when it comes down to motherhood, like, oh my goodness, I'm such an imposter trying to tell everybody that I'm a good mom, and I'm sitting here screaming at my kids because they're doing the same thing I just told them to stop doing again.
Right.
You know, so even just little things like that, it doesn't have to be on a grand scale, but just even starting something new, we get attacked with that when we start something that we feel like we're called to, and then all of a sudden we're just inundated with this negative thinking about who we are.
Right. So Holy Spirit, we just invite you into this conversation, and we just thank you so much for your presence and your guidance, and that you're in us, Lord. We just thank you for what you're going to speak through us and how you're going to impact moms through us. We just submit every word that comes out of our mouths to you. We just submit our mind and our will and our emotions to you, Lord. And I just thank you, God, for just giving us the opportunity to do this together as friends and sisters in you. We just seal this in the blood of Jesus and in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
So, Leslie, we have been talking lately about how we just have so many dreams and aspirations, but we've been moms most of our lives, right?
Yes.
So you were a young mom. I was a teen mom, and so we've kind of just spent our lives in motherhood. Even for myself, I've had a very up and down motherhood road that I've traveled just because I have children from different fathers. I started so young with my high school sweetheart and got married, had another child, ended up divorced because he had an affair, and then got into another relationship too quickly, had another child. It's just been a crazy, crazy journey for me. And and at that point, I wasn't spirit filled. So after my third child, I really came into relationship with the Lord and waited and ended up married quite a few years later to my now husband, who I have another child with. I haven't done the best job or the job that I would have loved to have done because of having different fathers and the ups and downs that going back and forth between broken homes. And it's been a difficult journey to walk. And then I have my now little 2.5-year-old Shalom, who's so precious. And I get hit by the enemy all the time with, you've failed with your other kids. You're such a bad mom. You're not ever gonna be able to raise a child properly, or, you know, all those things that come at you.
Right.
Just having to be like, okay, yes, my previous experiences have happened, but the only thing that I have control over right now is raising Shalom and being the best mom that I can be to her now. And I do still want to be the best mom that I can be for my older children as well.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just talk a little bit about how we've both had this imposter syndrome happening even over the podcast, you know, because
yes.
We have started this podcast together.
There's things in our life that we want to say, hey, we did do that. We did the best we could with what we had. Now we are just coming up and saying, Lord, have your way in us. And the enemy wants us to feel like we don't deserve that. And we have that root of pride there that we have to pull and say, it's not about me. It's about you, God, and what you want to do. And so we just decided to address it head on because we know we're not the only ones who feel this way. We're not the only ones who've made mistakes in life and mothering and all of those things. And just the way that I started my motherhood journey in itself was enough to have people turn their back on me, especially in the Christian world.
Right.
So the other night, Jackie was working through some stuff. Can you just share how you've been feeling the last couple of days?
We're making this Moms Impacting a Kingdom of God podcast. And I have three older children in Canada. I've moved to California with my husband. I called Leslie and I was like, okay, I haven't really been sharing a lot about the podcast, even though I feel so strongly that what we're learning as we're going is so important to share with others. But I haven't really been sharing it because A, I feel like a little bit of an imposter, and B, I'm a little nervous that the people in my life are going to hear that we're doing this podcast and try and tear it up and tear me up and talk about all of the negative things about my past or how I have no business doing this podcast because my three older children are in Canada with their fathers and I've left Canada. I have not left them. I'm still actively pursuing to be a part of their lives. Life and the Lord has taken us out of Canada and into the US and into California specifically. I just shared it with Leslie and I was like, so what do you think we should do? Leslie, what was your response? Do you remember?
Well, first, you are an amazing mom. You do these things for your kids. They don't even know yet.
Right.
And it's okay to feel that way. It's okay to feel like you've messed up because maybe we have.
Yeah.
My response was, hey, well, let's just tackle it. Let's just hit it head on. Let's talk about it. Let's talk about what the Lord has done in our lives. That's our testimony, right?
Right.
So when we have messed up in the past or we have done something that we wouldn't want our own children doing, then we just say, hey, this is what I did. This is what happened from it. And God uses everything for his glory. So if I can lay down my own preconceived thoughts about my past, then I can allow him to use that for his glory.
Amen.
And just being willing to do that and laying that down at the feet of Jesus and saying, okay, so if somebody wants to say something negative about me, okay, that's okay. You can have that feeling about me because maybe I did that thing that upset you and maybe reconciliation isn't in your heart right now, but but it is in my heart, and I do want to reconcile, and I do want forgiveness, and I do want to forgive and be forgiven.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was so refreshing to be able to call you and just share, you know, what I was thinking about and just lay it out there, and then have you come back with such a positive and encouraging statement towards me. It really touched my heart to be able to have that safe place in you. So one of the things I started hearing from the Lord was your past doesn't define your present, and your past doesn't define what I want to use you for today. And he just kept reminding me of all of the biblical patriarchs and all of the biblical superstars, if you want to even call them that, that really messed up. Like,
yes,
Moses really messed up. You know, he murdered an Egyptian guard, and he was disobedient to the Lord many, many, many times. We just have to remember that even if you mess up, God can still use us. Like, Moses couldn't even talk right. He had a stutter, but God used him powerfully. And then you go to even David.
Mm-hmm.
He murdered one of his front men that he was close to, sent him out on the front lines in battle so he knew he would be killed so that he could be with his wife.
Right.
And he committed adultery with her. That's pretty intense. But yet God said that David was the apple of his eye. God was so pleased with David. And what made them righteous before the Lord was repentance.
Yes.
And David genuinely went before the Lord, and he wept, and he repented, and he was sorrowfully sorry for what he had done. God forgave him. But here's the thing. There was still consequences that David had to suffer through because of that sin. His firstborn child ended up dying, and there was other things that he had to suffer through because of that sin. In my own personal life, there's things that I still have to suffer through because of my own past sin. But I can either focus on all of the negative things in my life, or I can implement the point of decision and the power of the shift. I can still move on. That doesn't have to define me forever.
Right.
Yes, it's part of my life. Yes, I wish things had been different, but I made those decisions when I made them, and unfortunately, I can't change them. All I can change is the decisions I make right now, today, and then move into the power of the shift, which is continuing with the podcast, continuing in home-based business, and not allowing that imposter syndrome to just wreck me.
Exactly. It puts us from reaction mode into responding mode. It says, okay,
yes,
I'm thinking about this. This is happening in my life. I can stop here and say, Lord, I need your help right now to respond appropriately. Because if I go into reaction mode, I haven't done anything better than I did in my past. Instead, and sometimes we still mess up that way. We still react. We still might yell. We might need to come to Jesus meeting. But
right.
But when Jesus comes and gets a hold of us, we can say, okay, now I have the tools to respond. I know about forgiveness. I know about grace. I know about refilling my well. I know about the things that are making me feel the way that I feel. And I can address those issues with the people in my life so that they understand where I'm coming from. They understand what I'm going through. And that was the whole point of us having that conversation, is because this whole process has been something very new for us. And we had to really overcome some obstacles and hurdles to be able to even find the time with four kids each and all of the things going on in our lives. And not to mention the physical limitations that you're having right now with the wheelchair and not being able to walk like you could even 6 months ago.
Right.
And being able to battle the thoughts of that and to be able to walk into your calling and say, wait a minute, I was going strong and now I'm just stopping in my tracks.
Right.
Instead, it's like, okay, well, I'm going to respond to the situation by, what can I do differently here? And what are you saying to me, God, about this?
Yeah, it's definitely been an interesting journey to really implement what we've been talking about, and really seeking the Lord and how he wants to use me in different circumstances, now that I went from being totally normal to having tingles in my toes one day, and then within a week being in a wheelchair, paralyzed from the waist down in intense neurological pain, but still moving forward. It's been a blessing and it's been extremely difficult at the same time. We also had another phone call. You were feeling some imposter syndrome and some overwhelm and had shared, am I supposed to just put all my goals and aspirations on the back burner because I have a newborn baby and a toddler now? But like, I don't want to wait till I'm 60 years old to do it.
Right. And I called Jackie because first we were going to work and I was like, I just need some friend time because I feel like I can't get anything accomplished. I feel like I'm stuck in perpetual newborn mom mode forever. I'm in a new marriage. So my first marriage failed.
Right.
I thought, hey, I can't even minister anymore because how am I supposed to help people accomplish whatever they want to accomplish in their life and walk in ministry and preach the word and then be divorced? It just didn't compute in my mind.
Right.
And the Lord had to really show me who I am in Him and that I'm not the sum of my mistakes. I'm not the sum of a divorce. Then having a new marriage, we started over with new babies.
Right.
But you don't start completely over because I'm bringing my children into this new marriage. And then now we're having more kids. And I was struggling with the feelings of, how can I still be a good mom to my older kids when now I have little ones?
Right.
And am I robbing them of their teenage years?
Right.
To be inundated with new babies, where the reality is this is growing them more than I've ever seen them grow. And it's been such a positive experience. However, I was just getting to the point where I could travel. My kids were, one's out of the house and one's a teenager, and we could do things together and could take the time I needed for myself. I could take the time to go and read and study the word. And then now having two new babies, I'm not over this yet. We're still working this out,
right.
But
yes.
I still feel kind of stuck in perpetual motherhood. And I was feeling the guilt of feeling that feeling because I don't want to feel that way towards my kids. I don't want to feel like, I don't want them to take from it and say, well, my life isn't good enough to be your purpose. But my purpose isn't just to be a mom.
Right.
My purpose is so much bigger than being a mom. And just being a mom is awesome. And it's wonderful.
Yes.
But that doesn't mean that's all I am. I called Jackie the other night and just said, I just need to talk about this because I feel like I'm robbing them of their childhood by trying to go for my dreams at the same time. And then I'm feeling guilty for needing time to myself. And I feel guilty for wanting something bigger and wanting to do something more, wanting to go after the Lord in different ways than just being at home. So,
yeah. And God's planted that desire in your heart and He's planted similar desires into my heart. And so when we're going after our calling, we feel like we're fulfilled, you know,
right.
And we're happy. But when we're not going after our calling, we feel like something's missing. And so, yes, we're called to be mothers, but we're called to be more than just mothers. Being a mother is not just our only identity. It's part of who we are. And we have to do our absolute best with what we're given as mothers. But I want to encourage you again, Leslie, though, like I look up to you so much for everything that you have accomplished. You are a doctor of education. You know, you have two older children who are thriving. They're amazing kids, you know, 16-year-old and 20-year-old who are both seeking after the Lord. They're both really amazing, intelligent, loving, thoughtful children. And then now you've entered into this new phase of motherhood for the second time in your life with your now husband, and you're going after it. I'm actually from Canada, and in Canada, we get a year and a half off of work paid.
Yeah.
And I shared with Leslie, like, she started going after things, you know, very quickly, very soon after her youngest was born.
You
know, and
yeah,
and I'm sure. Just so inspired by that because I'm used to something totally different. But a lot of mothers here in the US have to go back to work after 6 weeks.
It's really fast.
In Canada, they tell you not to even lift a finger until 6 weeks, let alone go back to work. You go back to work 18 months after the baby's born.
I think that sometimes that pressure from our culture can really get to us to have to go so quickly and feel like we have to fulfill something. And sometimes we just forget that this season is just this season.
Right.
And there's acceleration. God can accelerate us through different things if we can just respect our season. And that's been one of my struggles. I've had a hard time respecting my season.
Right.
even when Zion was born, it's a whole nother story, but I gave birth to both of my youngest at home. And that experience of giving birth at home really accelerated my healing, actually. I didn't have as many hurdles as I did with my first two. And I felt like I was supposed to get up out of the bed and do stuff immediately.
Right.
And even 4 days after Zion was born, I felt like I should be getting up and making dinner for my family and not respecting my season.
Right.
And I had to remind myself, I am allowed to rest. I am allowed to sit, lay here in this bed, nurse my baby, love on my toddler, and just be here for the moment. I don't have to conquer the world. I don't have to go anywhere. And that was probably one of the hardest things moving into this new season. And I'm still struggling. I haven't conquered it every day. I've conquered moments, you know, of respecting this season of life and coming up with solutions to be able to get the self-care that I need while respecting the season I'm in. When you have teenagers and you're past that little baby stage, it's a whole nother ball game to go back and do it again.
Right.
Because you've already been through it, so your mind isn't there anymore.
Right.
And there's things that you forget. Yep. There's things that they need that you've forgotten that they need. I had forgotten how 100% on I have to be with a toddler because otherwise, he's going to bite somebody or hit somebody or snatch a toy.
And,
and I can't have him biting and somebody left a knife on the counter. You know, I have a 16-year-old, so knives get left on the counter after cutting up cheese. And so
I have to remind my husband not to leave his pocket knife that is like a very sharp knife out. So yeah, I totally get it.
Who left the knife on the table? The baby can climb.
Right, you know? I know.
And just the level of not being able to zone out, you know, I don't have mental breaks really, because when I take a mental break and I zone out, somebody's getting hurt or somebody's falling, or you know, the toddler wants to climb on the baby and sit on her face and but even learning how respecting that season looks like, it's okay for me to say, hey, Chris, I need to take a bath and I need you to watch the babies so I can have some space in my brain and just soak.
Right.
He's so willing. He's so wonderful. He says, you said you wanted to take a bath. Why aren't you in the bath yet? I'm like, I don't know, because I had to prepare everything for you. He said, I'm capable. I'm good.
Yeah.
Get in the tub.
Let me handle it.
That's right, though, right?
Yes.
Got to be able to ask people for help. And sometimes that's hard to do. It's hard to ask for help when you feel like you should be the one conquering everything. And you can't.
It is.
And I can't. I just.
Absolutely. Especially going from like being a single mom for a while to being married again. Like when you were a single mom, you were having to take care of everything and think of everything and wear all the hats. And now you have a husband who's so willing. But you're still in that mind frame of like, I got to think of everything and take care of everything still. But it's also like another season where you just have to relinquish some of that control. And it's you having control is not a bad thing, but it's just about relinquishing it and remembering like, oh, yeah, I have a partner that's willing to like pick up what I've been carrying for so long. And it's such a blessing.
Oh, I know.
Such a blessing. So if you're a single mom out there, I just want to like lift my hat off to you and just encourage you as well that you're not alone. We're here for you. We get it. We understand. And I just want to encourage you too, right? I want to encourage you too, though, to just ask for help. If you have someone that's in your life that's willing to help, ask for help, because you don't have to carry it all.
Yes.
It's okay to like relinquish some of that control to those who want to help you. So obviously, you know, pray about it, vet them in the Holy Spirit, meaning like you want to make sure that you're getting help from people who are responsible and who are trustworthy with your children. But I just want to just encourage you that it's okay to get help and have that alone time, that time for just you to dream and to accomplish those goals and those visions that God's put into your heart. We've really just addressed this whole episode on imposter syndrome and, you know, feeling like you're not good enough, because we're in it. We get it. We're experiencing it. It's a mindset thing. I just want to stand on who I am, who I've been created to be, stand on what God has entrusted Leslie and I with, and just to share with you that we're not perfect and we haven't right. arrived, but we're here in humility, learning and growing with you, but wanting to share what God's leading us into and share the insight and the wisdom that we're seeking exactly. after with the people that we're interviewing and the things that we're going to be talking about, because we got lots to talk about that's going to grow you and really help your life just become easier. And we're going to be adopting these things. We're going to be doing them with you. And so it's just been such a blessing, Leslie, to just talk this out with you and to share and have this real talk.
It is nice to have a real talk. So you can expect to hear real talks probably once a month. As we go through things, we're just going to talk about the things that are going on in our life right then and just share with you and just be real with you and actually share the things that we're learning in the process, because that's what we do as moms.
Yeah.
We come together and we share and we talk about what's working and what's not working so that we can glean from each other.
Right.
And I just want to encourage any mom right now that feels the way I have been feeling lately or the way that Jackie's been feeling lately. I want to encourage you to respect your season.
Yes.
And to know that if you have a new baby right now, they are going to sleep through the night at some point. And they are going to learn to talk and walk and do things and play. And so I have to remind myself. And I want to remind you that if you're in that season at all, we both have one right in that thick of learning everything, taking everything in, and just the little bitty milestones that we can celebrate in the midst of it being difficult.
Yeah. Yeah. So I just love, though, too, that you're learning to respect your season.
Yeah.
But you're also doing the things that God's calling you to do.
Yes.
It's such a sweet, sweet reminder. Just to talk about this and have this real talk with one another. And I just hope that this has blessed you as you're listening. It's been such a joy to share this with you. And it does feel like, you know, weight has been lifted off, that I don't have to pretend.
Just talking about
it. Yeah, I get to talk about it. I get to be real. I get to admit to my flaws and my faults. And past is the past, and it's real and it's there. But again, doesn't have to define my today or your today. So. Thank you so much for jumping on. It's been such a blessing to be here with you.
Thank you so much for spending time with us today.
Thank you for being brave, for having your mind and heart open to receive what we've shared.
We pray that it touches you so deeply that you are transformed from the inside out.
If you've loved spending time with us as much as we have with you, we have great news for you.
We have a tribe of other moms just like you that are committed to living life to the fullest and are a source of encouragement, support, and love.
Go to Point of Decision on Facebook now to join our growing tribe.
I'm Dr. Leslie Bayless.
And I'm Jackie Bailey.
We love you.
We're praying for you.
And we are looking forward to spending more time with you on Point of Decision.